Ambarish Baliga joins in right now to speak about his sense of the fundamentals. Ambarish, lots to speak about. Thanks so much for joining in. But since we're on the topic of Mangalore Chemicals, you obviously read the news today as well. The stock is up 8%. Do you think that further, do you think a bidding war could be the case in point and maybe the stock could see higher levels as well?
In case there is a war between Zuari and Deepak to take over Mangalore, yes, then I suppose you could see higher levels. But then if you go purely by valuation, the property valuation, I think that's more important for Mangalore. I think the valuation should be closer to about 90-100. So generally you have a discount to that. So levels of about 70.
We'll just get that feed clearly, but this is pretty much what Ambarish was saying, that maybe the property valuation or otherwise is the bigger kicker for Mangalore Chemicals, and that stock is up close to 9% in the session, but could do more in the session today as well.
Before we go across to Ashwini and Mitesh and get in their ideas at 2:55, Mitesh, I just want to ask you for a chart check on Axis Bank. I mean, we are about 15:21 coming in on that stock, and the market is closely watching out for 15:44, which is the all-time high coming in for Axis Bank. The chart will just come up, but do you think it can go way past that? I mean, what's the outlook on the charts?
Stocks in the banking pack are, you know, giving you advanced breakout, in the sense that the Bank Nifty is yet to break into or get past earlier highs of 13,350. I think stocks like Axis Bank, ICICI Bank and Kotak Bank are breaking into all-time highs. Not ICICI Bank on a bar chart, but on the closing chart, yes. So I think these are the stocks which are showing the most promising patterns in the banking pack right now. So I would be positive on Axis Bank if it can sustain above 1490, 1495 and therefore keep a stop loss below those levels. Then I think the rally should continue and extend to about levels of 1620.
Okay, fair enough. Well, that's a quick call coming in on Axis Bank. Get an idea at 2:55. Come to you first. Ashwini, what is it that you'd recommend at this hour?
Well, for everybody who missed out on Z, that's a buy with a stop of 260. Look for targets of 282.
For Z Entertainment, 266.67 now for on the spot on Z. Mitesh, what about you? Your top trading idea at 255?
Yes, I think I would suggest a Lupin, that's the stock which is just about to break into all-time highs beyond the earlier highest closing of 995. So buy about 996, keep a stop below 980 and look for targets of around 1040 on the upside.
Focus on Pharma and Lupin on the other side of this very quick break. Stay tuned.
Well, welcome back. You're still watching Closing Trades right here on ET. Now, when we went into the break, we were talking about the move on Axis Bank. Of course, the market has come off from the day's highs, but still holding up at 68.29. But like we pointed out, some bit of profit booking and squaring off the positions. And that's had its impact on all the banking names as well. So Axis Bank also, from trailing an all-time high level of 15.44, it stepped down a bit lower now, sub 15.20 on that counter. Sugar has been active in the session today. Mitesh, just wanted a quick perspective on the momentum there and whether you would want to play it.
Yeah, I think I do like Bajaj Hindustan. You know, I think after a good rally to about levels of 20.5, it came down to sub 18 levels, took support on 21-day average. Is bouncing back again. I think this stock is clearly, you know, getting into a trend which could take it to about levels of 23.5 in the next few weeks to come by. So I would be positive. Use today's lowest stop loss and buy this stock.
Ashwini, a couple of days back, you were talking about the move in telecom, Bharti Airtel in the session.
See, it's a trading move. Maybe it can get up to 360 odd. But obviously, it's not a frontliner in terms of leading this market move, which is being led by PSU, infrastructure and rate sensitives. So if you can keep that in mind, I think you should be trading Bharti with a mindset where you take profits quicker than you would in other stocks.
Okay, Lupin is a stock in focus. Kamal Sharma, Vice Chairman of Lupin, joins us right now on the show. What's the rationale for this JV, Mr. Sharma?
The rationale of the JV is to, take the product into Japanese market. this is a product which biosimilars by nature need a clinical development which includes phase 1 and phase 3. And Yoshindo is a company which has an experience in this area. So we made a joint venture with them to take our product, which they are going to in-license into the joint venture, and clinically develop it in Japan for marketing in Japanese market.
But what is the financial implication of this deal?
So I think it is an equal joint venture. I obviously cannot share with you the equity structure, but we are equal partners in the output of this joint venture. They are in-licensing our product into the JV, and Lupin will be paid upfront payment and a milestone payments, and certain payment obviously would be due after it is approved by the regulator. And then once the approval is received, the dossier will be shared between Lupin and Yoshindo, and we would be marketing the products, two different brands in Japan of Etanercept.
Indicated that you'll be getting milestone based income. How much will that be?
Well, typical milestones in a exercise like this, there is an upfront payment, and there are stages which are defined in the agreement in terms of application, acceptance by the regulator, and then a certain phase of clinical development being completed, and then next phase, and then finally the approval. So that's a very typical scale of milestone payments.
Could you give us a sense of what is the return on investment that Lupin is targeting with this JV?
That's a bit far cry at the moment. I think the idea of building a joint venture was to be able to clinically develop the product in the market and then own the dossier jointly and then market. Obviously, I think what you must know at this juncture is that the current market for the product, which is marketed by Takeda in Japan, is almost $500 million. And if all goes well, probably we shall be the first company to launch in Japan, and therefore can expect a very good run on the product.
Just before we wrap up, Mr. Sharma, outside of Japan, which other countries are you targeting with this JV?
Well, this development is Japan specific, so this is going to cater to Japan. But obviously, when you have such valuable clinical data on a large product such as Etanercept, which probably is about a $7 billion plus worldwide product, that will be certainly useful in other geographies too.
We'll let you go with that, Mr. Sharma. Thanks so much for taking the time out and being with us. That's Lupin, and the stock has actually come off in the session. I think the markets too. By the way, no alarm bells, but the mid-cap and the small-cap indices are in the red. The Nifty is flat, just about 11 points in the green. So after notching up gains of going up to almost 6850, we're now at 6827. A cool-off in some of the gainers, but I think the losers there. IDFC is now down 2.5%, DLF 3.5%, BPCL has corrected almost 2% now, 474. So that one has gone down further. And select IT names, the likes of HCL Tech are down close to 1.5%. HCL Tech and Wipro, both of them have corrected quite a bit actually. Wipro, for the last 3 days, as much as L&T has gone up, Wipro has gone down. So it's looking fairly dismal for this one. But IT in general is not looking the strongest today. TCS 0.5% in the red. Best time to get in, Hemant Tukral. He joins in right now to talk about the expiry and talk about how the next series is expected to be. It's a difficult call on the next series, Hemant. So I'll first talk about the current expiry and what have you made of the gains. How are you approaching trades on the benchmark index and the bank Nifty?
Good afternoon, Neeraj. See, for the way the rollovers are happening, I still feel that the sentiment continues to be bullish. We last month also we discussed the rollover cost is still on a higher side. So clearly telling that people are more comfortable going ahead with long positions rather than short. See, what has changed for this series is now it's getting more and more stock specific. Within a sector also somebody is performing better rollovers than the other. So now we are entering a zone where Nifty may, as a whole index is not moving. It's more of a stock specific things that will make sure that Nifty remains buoyant. So I am not expecting Nifty to go below 6730-6750 mark even in the next series. And I am expecting it to first touch 6950 to 7000. Because 7000 is a psychological level where call writers have mounted positions in May. So that means that before election, maybe once we will visit, once we'll visit that psychological number of 6950 or 7000. So I would still continue to recommend to hold Nifty long, or even if you want to, because the options are very expensive in the next series. So that's why it's very difficult to go with an option trade. So otherwise I would have recommended buy call, but the stop loss would be 6730 for me in Nifty spot.
Right. On the options side, Hemant, what would be the position on the index if you wanted to play a range?
See, if we see the options, I think the 7000 call has the highest open interest than we. So that means till the election is not, doesn't goes out of our, as an event doesn't goes out, I am not expecting it to cross 7000 in a hurry. So that will be a real barrier for us. On the downside, the puts are distributed right from 67 till 65, though 65 put has the highest open interest. So the broader range, if we have to put from the writer's perspective, would be between 65 to 7000 till this election is planned out as an event. But we can't adjust the premiums because the premiums are so high, because if I start adjusting the premiums, the range will get broadened by another 200 points. So broadly, I would put it this way, the writer is not expecting it to break 65 or 7000 on the upside.
Hemant, so let's drill it down to individual names. I'm not asking you for your recommendations as of now, but amongst the best performers on the index, where do you see the patterns continuing? Say for example, a Larsen & Toubro or some of the PSU banks like BOB, PNB, which have performed.
See, I think as I said that if the rollover cost is positive or the bullishness will be maintained, I feel, before this event comes in, I have a feeling that high beta space will continue to outperform. So moment we talk about high beta, capital goods is obviously one which qualifies. So Larsen is one where I still feel there is a room 1450 to 1465. Within that, a mid-cap Crompton is also showing good rollovers. Now in banking, I would slightly be preferring the stocks like Axis, ICICI Bank, HDFC Bank, rather than going with the PSU Bank this time, because I have a feeling that the rollover cost of private banks is much better. So I would really would like to buy Axis Bank or ICICI Bank. See, Bob is an exceptional, it's a trading bet and it's an exceptional thing in within the PSU. But if you check the rollover cost of PSU lot with the banks, with the your private banks, the private banks are scoring much higher. So I would go with the private banks this time for the next series. Top pick would be ICICI Bank, where I feel that the stock can go up to 1350 to 1370.
By the way, Financial Technologies has fallen 5% if I'm not wrong. So that one is down. Look at MCX2, that one has fallen too. So both of these stocks have correcting. In fact, FT, I believe at 4.88, that's low circuit. MCX2 has fallen 2.5%. Not the best of days for these two stocks. Amrish Baliga is with us as well. Amrish, amongst the results today, particularly Yes Bank and all the news surrounding Yes Bank as well, what would your advice be and what did you make of the numbers per se?
Numbers, in fact, were slightly better than what we were expecting, both on the asset quality front as well as the net interest income. So I think one should look at still holding on at these levels, and whatever rumors, so-called rumors, which were there in the morning papers, if that is true, then possibly you have, I think, much more upside for that stock.
Amrish, that aside, what's your advice been to your clients or for the portfolios or the money that you manage? Because 15 days away from the big event or 20 days away from the big event, How are you positioning the money of the clients?
Right. In fact, we were bullish on the markets for quite a while. I think the last 4 to 5 months, we were talking of the pre-election rally, and it has played out exactly the way we thought it would. I think the best possible outcome is more or less getting priced into the markets, but there is still some more upside. Clearly, we see the markets more towards that 7,000 levels before the election results are announced. But then I think it is prudent to start booking out to a certain extent, because still the ground reality, I mean, hasn't really changed very much. And once you have a stable government in place, the expectations would be quite high to see those changes happening immediately. But we should remember, sentiments can change overnight in the market. Exactly, that's what we have seen in the past couple of months. But the ground reality does not change overnight, and I think we should remember that clearly. And right now, we have that arbitrage between the sentiment and the ground reality. I think you should utilize that, book out to a certain extent at higher levels, and at least take some profits off the table. I'm not saying sell off the portfolio, it's still time to remain in the market, but it is time to book out to a certain extent.
But the excitement around policy related stocks, do you think stepping into the new series that will only build ahead of the election result?
Absolutely. I think you'll have some more build-up happening as and when you have more sort of opinion polls and sort of news coming on the election front. But then what I'm saying is the risk-reward ratio at higher levels may not really be too favorable, because the best is getting priced in. And in case there is a slip, because finally it's elections, you don't know what the final outcome could be. We have seen that happening in 2004 when the outcome was clearly different than what people are expecting. In case there is some sort of a slip, then I suppose the downside is much more than what upside we have seen till date. So it's better not to take that risk completely on your portfolio. It's surely time to hedge to a certain extent, and one of the hedges I would say is to book out to a certain extent and keep some cash on the table.
Keep some cash on the table, indeed. Thanks for that advice, Amrish. Okay, I think we'll just go across to what dealing rooms are saying as well. But I just want to point out Biocon. That one is down 4.5% today. I think Espirito Santo came out with a tactical sell call on Biocon ahead of its numbers, and that stock has reacted duly, 4.5% down now. On a day when some of the other pharma stocks are still doing okay.